Stop blocking housing!
Stop blocking housing!
Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing! Stop blocking housing!
Stop blocking housing!
How are you?
Very good. How are you doing?
Number two, the freedom of worship. And yet, today,
it has to be said, that includes those who worship within the great faith of Islam. The freedom from economic want, that is a decent job, and the assurance that you can feed your family. And by the way, FDR made it clear that he also included adequate health care and social security into this freedom from economic. And finally, the fourth freedom, the freedom from fear. The comfort that you and your loved ones will not be preyed upon by predators, foreign or domestic. And yes, that includes, unfortunately, even those predators who sometimes wear uniforms and badges. In later years, the Democratic Party fought to add other fundamental rights to Roosevelt's list, like the equal right to jobs and education, and the right to affordable health care. Today, particularly in cities like San Francisco, where the uncontrolled forces of the market have thrown thousands of people out of their homes, like some Godzilla picking up buildings and shaking men, women, and children into the streets, today we have a crying need for another fundamental freedom, the right to shelter. This is a human right so essential, like food, health care, public education, and civic protection, it should not be left to the cold forces of the marketplace to provide. It must be the duty of our elected officials to fight and secure this basic right for everyone. As a society, we've agreed that people must not be allowed to starve to death in our streets, that every child, no matter what the economic ability of their family, must be guaranteed an education. And we pay taxes to ensure that we will be protected from crime and fire. But all too often, when it comes to that basic right of shelter, families are left on their own, to the mercy of landlords and a real estate industry motivated only by greed. And instead of protecting us from these forces of greed, too many of our local leaders are bought and owned by them. The real estate industry floods our state and local democracies with its campaign dollars, and the public debates about housing and its essential corollary, public transportation, are generally controlled by these special interests. But not tonight, folks. This evening, we are honored to have three political leaders who have devoted themselves to serving the public good. And tonight's town hall will be your night, a night dedicated to exploring together the solutions to our urgent housing and transportation problems, solutions that must benefit the majority of Californians. So thank you for putting up with my initial remark. And with that, I'm going to start introducing our guests for tonight. I am very pleased to introduce our first guest. She was the first Korean American elected to a public office in San Francisco. She served on the San Francisco Board of Education, and she now very ably and very brilliantly represents District 6 on the Board of Supervisors. And we hope that she will be representing the entire city in the state senate next year. Lateefah Simon. I didn't get out to your full introduction, but let me finish. So Lateefah is, of course, a California State University trustee and of the Acanito Foundation, which is a foundation that funds racial justice projects, very worthy causes, and a candidate for District 6, District 7, on the BART. And finally, the former mayor of Los Angeles, the Honorable Antonio Villaregosa, who, among other things, was the Speaker of the California State Assembly, was a co-chair of the 2012 Democratic National Convention, and we hope has some other offices in mind in the near future. Mr. Mayor, please join us. Supervisor, you've been in the thick of this battle, the battle for affordable housing. That's the great question before the city today, is who gets to live in San Francisco? And even if you're from a family that's lived here for multiple generations, there's no assurance, as you know, that you will be able to continue living here with your family. So I know that you and others, Supervisor Aaron Heskin, who's also with us tonight, worked hard on this question of affordable housing, which is such a critical one. Tell us, Jane, what you think are the crucial obstacles at this point to trying to get public solutions, progressive public solutions.
Coffee shops that are popping up across the city. And I'm also proud to have worked with 10% to 25% affordable housing on site 2 weeks ago. Is impossible. 2 weeks ago, without any additional upzoning or height or density, developer outright agreed to do 25% affordable housing. We also need to give more from the public investment in terms of housing. There was a time in the 60s and 70s where there was actually more public housing than people on the wait list. And starting with the Reagan administration, we started slashing funding to HUD, close to 50% over three administrations. At exactly the same time, homelessness started developing as an urban phenomenon in cities across the country at the same exact time. So for anyone that says that housing is not the solution to homelessness, they're wrong. Housing is absolutely the only solution. They have done amazing work in this area, but the final thing I will say is that what is most tragic in our country today is the fastest growing demographic in our homeless count here in San Francisco, in LA, in New York, in Seattle, are families. Families are the fastest growing demographic in our homeless count in cities across the country, and they are working families. And we are seeing them in our tents, we are seeing them in cars, they're couch surfing, they're in our shelter system. And this is a moral dilemma that cities need to address. And I believe that it's far more than a San Francisco issue. This is a state issue. Over 20% of the nation's homeless count is in the state of California. We as a state need to address homelessness. No single city can do this alone. And so we as a state need to heavily invest in housing, because no family that is working should be homeless on our streets.
You have roots, obviously, family roots, deep roots in this area as well, and many of us have seen how this once very diverse, vibrant city has become more and more homogenized. And diversity has become, wrapped up with this issue of affordability. As someone who's trying to get on the BART board, it might be a little puzzling to some people what you could do on the BART board to help address these issues. How do you think you can attack the problem of affordable housing and diversity from your office on the BART board?
Run like hell and win this election, that's what. Thank you for having me on this panel. It's a very special day for me. It's my late husband's birthday. His name was Kevin Weston. And a lot of the work that I do is in his memory as a radical journalist. And he would always say, even when he was living, pray for the dead, but fight like hell for the living. And being born and raised in the Fillmore here, my grandpa in the 40s opened up the first 8 African-American jazz clubs. That folks invoked and made sure that low-income and middle-income organizers and outreach workers and artists actually had place and space within the developing spheres of San Francisco that actually today. You know, I decided to run for the BART board for a number of reasons, and why we see women of color all around the country running for positions that we were told we weren't supposed to be in, because it's overtime, right? It's overtime. Everywhere, upwards from Crockett and Hercules and Stockton and Tracy. Bay Area will look like. We are now a regional space. And so, yes, I believe that folks who have civic life here, spiritual life here, they were born here. My little baby, one was born here. Hell yeah, I want to run the BART because I want it to be affordable. I want it to be accountable. I want it to be accessible to low-income folks and disabled folks and families. Do you know that a woman who lives in Richmond, who cleans bathrooms and rooms at the Hyatt, has to spend $300 a month just on BART to get two more accounts to be in BART and that transportation is not subsidized by her employer? So again, imagine having somebody, and hopefully a few, extremely progressive people on the BART board who think about effective law enforcement. Like San Francisco, we make sure that young people who are just trying to get to school can actually ride public transportation for extremely low cost for free. That's what I'm about. Imagine a child who gets evicted from their Mission Street home and goes to this school, and it's the middle of the semester. Why would we disrupt that child's life if we do? So why shouldn't that child be able to get from El Cerrito to 16th Street for free? I mean, these are human rights issues.
Transportation, urban planning. What I did, and working with a lot of people, by the way. I didn't do it all myself. It was supportive, the kind of people that you have here. Was I said, this isn't just about addressing the fact that, you know, people spend on average about 90 hours stuck in LA traffic. It's not just about the carbon emissions that drove the fact that LA had some of the dirtiest air. It's not just about moving people. It's about reimagining the city. And I think what you're saying is that in this great, you know, San Francisco, we got to reimagine a city where poor people and working people get to live here. We got to reimagine a city where people can work close to where they live, where they can shop and play, and their kids can go to school in and around where they work and live. Someone said just the other day that a housekeeper or a hotel worker living in Modesto is a flat tire away from no livelihood when they have to work here in San Francisco. And so to create a reality where we are encouraging, and by the way, just so that you know, everybody, I was president of the Conference of Mayors. I don't know a city where anyone has been able to get on a private development 40% affordable housing. Zoning ordinance, but it was at 15%. The fact that you were able to do that and do it successfully and that now you're working on the 25% standard makes a whole lot of sense. I mean, San Francisco has the highest rents here in the country, or certainly in the state. It's probably right up there with New York. It's close to up there with New York as far as maybe higher. Higher.
I stand corrected.
But you know, LA has the highest lack of affordability, and the reason is because we have a higher poverty rate. In fact, we have more, a higher rate of people who are renters. And we've got to change that reality. And I just want to end with another, we're going to ask a few more questions. I want to end with Jane is right as she runs for state senate. The state ought to be a partner in that. You know, I've been on a now 44-day listening tour up and down the state, and wherever I go, on the coast particularly, but throughout the state, people are talking about housing affordability. And the fact that you have come up with the notion that this ought to be a state responsibility too makes a whole lot of sense. And as we go into the rest of the evening, I'll talk a little bit about some of the things we did at the federal level that we could do at the state level as well to kind of encourage smart growth, smarter than planning, that includes poor and working people. Because great cities aren't great with, you know, a demographic of just the rich, working people and people who are, you know, strivers. And I think that the paradigm that you're trying to create is one where the strivers get to live here too. And I commend you for that.
Start reading some of the questions from the audience that have been passed up to me, but I do want to mention the fact that we are now at capacity. These people are so popular, you pack the room. So, but we have additional seating in the balcony. So if you're just coming in now, check out the balcony. And I'm sure the view up there is great. I do want to put, because my role is strictly journalist, one kind of tough question to the panel and specifically Jane, before we open it up though to questions from everyone else. I talked earlier in my opening remarks about how, unfortunately, many of the public policy debates and solutions are often dominated by corporate interests that can afford to fund campaigns and so on. The Salon our corporation is one of the bigger names in the Bay Area and elsewhere, the major development developer, and it throws its money around. It pays for think tanks, it pays for campaigns, and so on. Many people, including the main progressives in town, are not happy with proposition, which exempts Lennar from the limits that were placed on new office space in town. People have begun to feel that there's too much emphasis on building office space without building the housing that we need to go along with it. Proposition O, and you are no friend, by the way, of the big corporate developers in general. They don't see you as their servant, and because you do are a champion of affordable housing. But in the case of Proposition O, some of your progressive friends have criticized you for that position, so I just have to put that question to you. Why you support Proposition O?
The Lennar development was before my time on the San Francisco Board of Supervisors, but there was already a pre-existing agreement on the levels of affordability that would be hit and marked in the shipyard. It was a multi-development project. In fact, in two of the three projects that I negotiated, both at Seawall Lot 337, which is a giant, otherwise known as the giant parking lot, but also 5M, 5th and Mission, where we achieved 40% affordable middle-income housing, it was a mix of office and commercial and affordable housing. And part of how we help projects pencil out is that we also allow developers to build office because it is lucrative, and there's a jobs housing linkage fee that activists here fought for. They said that there is a linkage between building office and the need for affordable housing. And so for every square foot of commercial that you build here now, and this is fought for, commercial developers have to contribute what is known as the jobs housing linkage fee. And this is funds and fees that comes into the mayor's office to San Francisco and helps pay for more affordable housing. That was part of the entire deal and why I'm supporting Proposition O on the ballot today. But I do think that as we talk about what it means to develop and grow the city, but also to build higher levels of affordability, it is also about making sure that we are building in the fees that allows us to build that affordable housing as well.
Thank you. Let me jump off of that question to the other two guests tonight also. This larger question of the corruption of politics and how money floods our campaigns. And you, all three of you as progressives running for public office, you have to come up against this problem every campaign you run. You're usually outspent by candidates who have infinitely more money than you do. Bernie Sanders, once again, demonstrated this problem when he was running the primary. He, though, had enormous grassroots support, which points towards one solution, obviously, to this problem. But how do you, as progressives, vying for office against people who are often way outspending you? How do you grapple with this issue?
I am shocked at the lack of democracy in democracy. Here in San Francisco was to try to get politicians fired, right? And being on the other side of the full board, demanding justice when the police killed my very good friend, Eugene Stelly, or when we were really trying to get school reform, even back into my days in the 90s and trying to get condoms in schools and starting GSAs. I went to Washington. I know I'm in Mission House, but all I have to say is that I have this idea of if we just fight power, we can win. And now I realize I'm just so tired of begging people to make things good for my people that I have to run, right? So I get in this situation, and I think that, I have to raise like $250,000 to be on the BART board. Like, yes, the BART board. Making decisions early. I won't take money from contractors because guess what? Like, contractors come in front of the BART board to make decisions. Or when you have big oil, that will literally call you and say, would you like a lot of money? It is really important, I think, and I've learned from good people to say, hell no. Let's just be clear about that. I ride BART every single day. As many of you know, I'm not a driver. But my goal was to raise money to also show what progressives can do. And actually, in San Francisco, let's clear. I'm not progressive. I'm a radical, right? Me resources, but know this, you will never, ever, ever buy me, right? And we know we have people like Shirley Chisholm, we have folks like Shirley Huggins, we have folks like Betsy Smith who inspire us in song and in movement. But let's be clear that within the democracy of local politics, especially being a woman of color, especially not coming from money and not having a huge white male base, right? We work 10 times harder for every single dollar. Right? Our health when we do win, we prove so strong. But it's difficult. It's difficult. And I think we have to set, for those of you who are thinking about running for office, give the babysitters now. But what we have to do is think about who we are truly accountable to. And it is, for me, it is baby mothers on the BART train, and it's homeless men who are actually sleeping and sometimes dying in their own urine. It's people that we are forgetting about who deserve, including all of the writers, of course. But when we make things better for the least among us, every one wins.
Right way. I won by going directly door to door to
to our voters every night in the evening, door knocking and on the weekends. And at the end of the day, I met more people than my opponents did. And we knew they weren't going to get a mailer saying the Democratic Party endorses James Kim. And you won't be getting one this year either. Even though I was the top vote getter for the Democratic Party as well. Not for the tremendous generosity of so many people that get involved in the work that we do. But I will say this, in raising this kind of money, I spend a disproportionate amount of my time with people with money. I spend a disproportionate amount of time, and even if they do not impact my vote, ultimately as a board of supervisors or on the state senate, I spend less time, not even just with our low-income residents, but our middle-class residents as well. And to me, in the long term, besides overturning Citizens United, and by the way, I asked my opponent to commit to a pledge saying that if any independent expenditures came on our behalf, that we would commit that same amount of money to charitable contributions of the other opponent's choice to keep IE out. So we would tell all of our supporters, we don't want you to come into our campaign because you will cost us if you do. Keep turning that pledge down. And until we overturn Citizens United, until we do that, we need more and more candidates that are willing to make public pledges like that and say, we don't want independent expenditures in our race. We don't want that kind of money in there. But in the long term, I think it is far worthwhile. It is a good investment of the public to invest in candidates who are running for office. We have a great public financing program here in San Francisco, and it allows people to actually be independent when they come into office.
Indeed, it's actually, it saddens me because there's not a plethora of jobs within retail. We have front of the house and back of the house races within retail. I mean, on to our corporate sector, right? So I want to look at all these issues from an intersectional lens, but for real, if I can't, as a black woman, get a cab in the middle of the city, I'm calling Uber. I'm calling really, really important for every single new economy that comes into our city, into the Bay Area. We demand that their executives do right by the people who are making them money, right? And more importantly, as we think about our transportation system, I mean, there are parts of the city that are transportation deserts. And I know folks that maybe have been working really hard on it, and many of our operators are working class people of color, have families. They actually get the brunt of oftentimes bad planning when people miss buses or it's raining and they're passing up seniors. The same with BART. The BART system, it has actually outlived its time. It's reached the end of its own destination. And so we actually really deeply need just a new vision and a new life, figuring out how to connect AC Transit and Muni and BTA and BART to ways that actually deeply speak to the user. I would actually like to see public transportation be thought of as a public good. The fact that we do not have buses for our children to get to school, children are on buses every single day. How dare we kind of think and collapse this idea that privatization is a way to get people to and fro. I'm not with that, but I realize the reality is, because I know so many single mothers, I know so many disabled people, they are either driving these cars or begging for rides, right? So as we kind of look at the next 30 years within transportation justice movements, we know that the issues are complicated, but by God, there is no reason that we can't facilitate service to make sure that working class people can actually get home to work, to treatment, and to be a part of civic life. Uber and Lyft and the other services are also, many have said, you know, part of a conversation of economic apartheid. Some can, some can't. And I think that just as long as we have the some can't in this city, there is in the Bay Area, there's so much work to do because everybody got to get somewhere. And everybody should have an equitable way and a fast and safe way to get there.
Thank you. This is a statewide question. Recently, Governor Brown proposed a controversial measure, the Buy Right Law, that would have fast-tracked development in cities like San Francisco, overriding local restrictions and laws. It was defeated.
But it took a long time, and there was a lot of opposition, and a lot of it was based on these class differences. You know, I don't want this it just depends. You know, I think you got to make sure that there's a lot of community input. You got to make sure that
The law, though, tended to address just housing development. It wasn't transportation projects.
I'm not familiar with the legislation that you're talking about. That's why I'm speaking more generally to it. So for housing development, if it was affordable housing, I think there could be a bargain there. You know, one of the arguments that developers make about affordable housing is that it costs too much and that they don't get it back. So if you can give them an opportunity to cut the time and give up, you know, a 25 to 40% affordable housing, that's a conversation we ought to have. I'm not sure that this piece of legislation did that. I imagine it didn't. But those are conversations that we ought to be able to have. And I got to believe that Jane was able to, to get a 40% rate. I'm telling you, I've never heard that before, and I know that you did that in a free project. To be able to do that, you had to give them something. I think we ought to be able to have those conversations. And so, as a general proposition, I don't know what the specific legislation said. What I mean, so to answer the question, if I were in that job, could I support that? It would depend. My guess is they didn't have anything like 40 or 25%, so the answer would be no.
Jane, next question is to you. There's been an arising storm over Airbnb, and it's throwing clout here in San Francisco and many cities, and the sense that it's displacing many people, the sort of spread proliferation of Airbnb hotels. So this question is from someone who says, why is it acceptable for companies like the Bill Group to demolish the Market Street Cinema to build an Airbnb hotel right next door to me, and without seismic protection for neighboring residential apartment buildings? This is not just annoying, but it's endangering residents. Multiple people have already been forced to move out of my building because of constant shaking. For weeks now, multiple tenants complained to the DBI, but it's gone nowhere. What will be done about that?
So I actually saw this question, but I also don't know this development that we're speaking of. Thank you, Supervisor David, for being here today. Appropriate that Supervisor Compos walked in because he was the leading spokesperson on the board to talk about how short-term renters is hurting us here in San Francisco. Now, I should be clear. I'm okay with true sharing short-term rentals. If you're going under a certain number of nights because you go on vacation for 2 weeks or for a weekend, I think that there should be a way for us to let you do some type of short-term rental. It is a reality. Many people feel like they need to get support from that income. But what we are seeing in the data that's being put forward is actually the vast majority of the units that are being put on Airbnb are entire units. And they're being done for far more than 2 nights, 14 nights. In fact, many people came in and said, I want to be able to do this 365 days a year. Well, if you want to do this for 365 days a year, there's actually a permit for you. It's called a bed and breakfast permit. And we allow you to run a commercial business in your residence. And to do that, you should go through the process to be able to do that. Now, zoning. I didn't really understand this until I got on the board of supervisors. The planning document is actually a document of what we think a healthy city looks like. How much housing, where, how dense, how tall, for what affordability rate, how much office, how much hotel, how much manufacturing, and all of this, how much open space, etc. And all this goes into, this is what we think a healthy city looks like. Now, office manufacturing, they create and generate certain types of jobs. We want to make sure we have a mix of all those arts and everything, which is why we have Proposition X, by the way, on the ballot this November to protect arts, manufacturing, and repair. And make developers rebuild a portion of not when they demolish that, because those are jobs that we are losing. It is not just the businesses. Those are jobs that we are losing. But when you start to ravage the housing zoning and turn that into a hotel, then you start to lose units and keep them off the market. And that is only exacerbating the housing crisis here in San Francisco. So I do think that there is a compromise. There is a solution to move forward. But we have to make sure that we're not doing it at the risk of losing real residents. And right now, if you really have that extra bedroom, we want you to get a roommate. We want someone to permanently live here in San Francisco. That allows you to do 365 days a year. We said we were open to it, but we wanted a hard cap on the number of nights that you could rent out a room or a couch in your house. You know, 60 days, 90 days, something that puts a limit on how much you can do. So it's true short-term rental. But if you're doing it 365 days a year, that is a business, that is a hotel. We have zoning for that, and if you aren't zoned for that, you can go through the conditional use process in the planning department and apply for a bed and breakfast permit.
For you, and relates to another sore point in the city, Google buses. I moved back to San Francisco last year because I could no longer tolerate the BART commute to and from the East Bay. I returned to the city after being away for 5 years, and I found that the Google buses had since multiplied like crazy. I'm not rapidly anti-Google bus, but I do worry that we are creating a two-tiered society in San Francisco, where some people ride in luxury buses down to the peninsula while everyone else piles onto underfunded and overcrowded BART and muni systems. I'm concerned that the city is filling up with people who no longer have a stake in our public life and public transportation.
We are less than 3.
of life. We got to bring it back. People deserve to be able to live in the neighborhoods that where they gave birth to their children, or where they laid down the streets to demand that AIDS drugs be available to people who were dying. I mean, this is our for folks who were able to live throughout the mission and raise their children and actually have culture. They're in Stockton, so let's bring it back.
Speaking specifically about the Google buses, since they do have a big impact on the city streets, on the congestion, and wear and tear on the streets and so on that cost public money, would you advocate raising the taxes on these corporate commuter buses?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So we every single employee who gets on that bus has an employee perk, right? And you have the abuelita who is still on the side who has to pay to get on BART, Muni, and AC Transit. And so, again, it's corporate transportation and not public transportation, but I believe, like any business, you pay the fair cost for doing business in this city, and this city should be about equity, it should be about deep equality, and so how you do that is you pay your fair share as a corporation.
Biggest issues with commuter shuttle bus program when it came to the board 2 years ago was the $1 per stop fee. Now, I know that we have slightly raised those fees, but when we are towing cars away for over $400, and we're putting the director of SFMTA's salary into their cost recovery, and then we're saying $1 per stop at a bus stop for commuter shuttle bus, I want to know that we have a consistent standard for how we do, you know, the cost recovery fee. And I don't understand it. I serve on the board of supervisors, and I don't understand how SFMTA does cost recovery. And it was one of the questions that I had asked a lot about during the CEQA appeal that was filed by appellant 2 years ago, which was, how did you get to a dollar? How do you know you don't need more parking control officers to regulate this many buses on the street? And why is it that a mother that is dropping her kids off in school at the bus stop gets a $179 ticket because she has nowhere else to stop her car?
Leadership that you have there. I mean, shared economy. I said, what do you think about it? He said, I think the shared economy is great. I just think they ought to share. Everybody, where are we going? I mean, you said it, and I'm with you. The notion that you would have housing that's used, you know, in a limited way, people being able to make a few dollars when they're not in their home, that's one thing. The fact that you get whole buildings, it's not just happening in San Francisco, it's happening in L.A., it's happening in New York, it's happening whole buildings. Yeah, that's got to be policed and regulated. That's just unacceptable. The notion that you don't pay taxes. I mean, you just said, you either get a... I mean, like, everybody pays taxes. And everybody should pay taxes.
Not an apple in Europe.
Well, I wouldn't know. So, these aren't... By the way, these aren't radical notions. You know, I would disagree with the notion that this is radical. This is decent. This is who we are. This is what we're supposed to be. We, you know, the Golden State can't be a place where it's just a few of us and live in, you know, in beautiful parts of the state, and the rest of us are commuting, you know, an hour and a half and 2 hours away, and our kids in schools that aren't challenging them and not making a wage that they can live on and no health care. And, you know, I mean, this is not the future. It can't be our future. So when I hear these two people speak in the way that they do, both of them have said, look, I can support corporate commuter buses, and I'm for the shared economy and for Airbnb, but we all got to have a conversation about what the rules are. And not just the rules for people who are poor and are working and the middle class, but the rules for the wealthy and the powerful. We can't live in a place where there's one set of rules for them and another set of rules for the rest of us. So I hear them thinking in the way that they do, and these aren't, I challenge the notion that this is radical. This is fair. This is right. This is just. This is equity. And this is in all of our self-interest. We don't do well when just some of us get to eat the cake and the frosting. We do well when we all are eating and thriving.
Yeah.
And making investments like affordable housing. And you, again, bringing it back to Jane, who's arguing that the state has to be a partner. It can't just be the city of San Francisco or the county, and city and county, I forget that. In L.A., it's just a city, we don't have a county. I always wanted to have a city and county vote, but we didn't get that. But, you know, we got a partner here, and the private sector's got a partner. You know, you want the kind of private sector growth that you have here. But as you said, as you're building office buildings, you got to have housing for people. When you have commuter, you know, corporate commuter transit, you know, the janitor's got to get on the bus too. So these aren't, I think we got to have a conversation, not just in San Francisco, but throughout this state, of what kind of place do we want to live in? Is this the future? You know, the shared economy, we all know that we're going to driverless cars. Do you know the number one occupation for people that don't have a college degree is driving? What are we going to do with them? What's our collective responsibility? So these things are all connected, and I'm just sitting here marveling like the rest of you. That's why you're clapping so hard, because this is the kind of leadership that we need to want to challenge these notions. You know, we can have a shared economy, just let's all share. We can, you know, have commuter buses and you know, Airbnb, but it's got to be done in a way where we're not just obliterating, you know, the poor and the working people and the people who are striving in this town. Because I would commit to you, those are the people that made San Francisco great. I know they're the people that made LA great and the people that made this country great. So thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to make before I read the question, which is obviously we produced Ronald Reagan during this state, and sorry, America. My father served with Ronnie on the Screen Actors Guild board many years ago, and Nancy Reagan, he said, would send in the signal to play the plays to Ronnie even then. He couldn't believe it when he became president later. In any case, from that period on, really government was portrayed as the problem. And the conservative revolution did a very successful job of convincing many Americans of that. And unfortunately, the Democratic Party bought into that notion to a great extent. You know, it seems obviously at this point, what we read from that is this grotesque imbalance of wealth in our society, where a tiny fraction controls greater and greater percentages of the wealth. And therefore, we finally are starting to have some pushback. The Occupy movement, the Bernie Sanders campaign, and so on. And we now have progressive policymakers and radical political leaders who are starting to come up with a new philosophy that government actually does have a role to play in our public life. And in fact, we desperately need government to play that role on behalf of most of the citizens. So the question here really speaks to that. We're starting to see some interesting progressive solutions proposed at the state and local level, and hopefully someday at the national level. And here's one. State Senator Mark Leno got a bill to the governor's desk recently, just yesterday. This is a positive bill, says this questioner, aimed at addressing the growing numbers of educators who are being priced out of their cities, not just in San Francisco, of course, but Tony in Los Angeles.
And we actually reimagined the city and did a lot of planning around transit lines. That's the place where you can really grow affordable housing along transit lines, and creating zoning changes that allow you to do that, right? To have density bonuses, not the parking, the parking variables, really can help to spur affordable housing in those places.
Jane? Yeah.
So when I was on the school board, most of my time I spent saying, oh, we just don't have enough of this. Depending on which analysis you look at, we are roughly 47, 46 in the country in per pupil spending. And that means roughly three or four states spend less than we do on every student. Yet we educate, close to one out of every five children in the United States. This is a really big issue. But there was one thing I realized about 2 years into my term that we actually had too much of. We had too much land. And so I started questioning, well, we're trying to close the opportunity gap here in San Francisco, the achievement gap, the opportunity gap. So why don't we actually use our land to generate value to close that gap? Because the immediate instinct was, let's sell our land and then we can start pumping that money into the school district. But that's a finite amount of money. And based on state law, when you sell school property, you can only use it to invest in facilities. You can't actually put it into a classroom. So that's one restriction that we have to get around. So what if we started looking at a surplus property and said, well, what are the reasons why students are not achieving in school, right? Some, not enough grocery stores. A lot of our students live in food deserts where they don't have access to fresh and healthy food. So if we have surplus property in the Tenderloin and the Bayview, let's rent to a grocery store. Let's rent below market and let's actually get access to fresh and healthy food in the neighborhood. Or let's build affordable housing. And so actually on my term on the Board of Supervisors, we were looking actually right down the street on Mission between 16th and 15th. It was a vacant site in Phoenix High School, a continuation school here in San Francisco. It had been vacant for many, many years. And we're finally, thanks to working with Supervisor David Compos's office, we had an RFP go out to build affordable housing on that site. And it will be affordable family housing. And that is incredible. According to the Mayor's Office of Housing, here in San Francisco that a two-teacher household could afford. Not a single home that a two-teacher household could afford here in San Francisco. So we are losing our teachers. And this is a real story. This is not just anecdotal anymore. Principals are losing teachers because they can't afford to live anywhere near to teach the students that they love teaching every day. But we do have a restriction. Senator Mark Leno is helping to address that, which is we can't use state or federal funds and just house teachers, because that's discrimination. And by the way, that's based on good laws. Most laws have good intentions. You know, for housing, you don't discriminate based on race and profession, gender, all of those things. But in this case, school districts were hampered from building teacher housing because we couldn't use public dollars to get there. We had to do 100% private financing. It is what Santa Clara did. They did it through certificates of participation. It was very expensive for them to do it that way, but they did it. But very few districts are willing to put their budget and fiscal liability in order to do that. So those are some of the few changes that we can make at state level. Second, the state must invest in teacher workforce housing. We have to make sure that we are actually investing public dollars so teachers and firefighters and policemen can actually live locally in the cities that they serve. And finally, the one last thing I should add, you know, I talk about this a lot, but the budget document is actually a document about our values and our priorities. It is one of the most important things that any elected official does, whether they are on the school board, like Sandra Lee Fuhr, who is here in the room today. And the state legislature and Congress. And when you look at the document, it's not just a series of line items and dollar signs. It is a statement about who we care about and who we prioritize. So how much do we invest in schools? How much do we pay those teachers that teach in the classroom? Where do we invest in trees and parks and in what neighborhoods, police officers? All of that is in our budget. So that is the document and that we should all be looking at. And it is an investment of all of our money. It is our public investment back into our schools, our city, our state, and our country. And we really need to examine how we're spending that. This is the one last example that I'll give before I hand it over to Lateefah. Over the last 30 years in the state of California, our budget has largely looked about the same. It grows and shrinks, but proportionally it's about the same. 40% K-12 community college, 30% health and human services, and the final 30% goes to everything else. Now, there are two line items that changed significantly over the last 30 years. And you can guess it. The first is prison spending. It went from 3% of our budget to 9%, 6 percentage points. One other line item changed, and can you guess what it is? Higher education. Cal State University, UC, went from 18% to 12%, exactly 6 percentage points. So that is a statement about where the state of California is investing its dollars, our dollars, and where it expects young Californians to end up in. We built 23 state prisons in the last 30 years, and we only built one UC and three CSUs. If you went to UC Berkeley 30 years ago, we covered 81% of your tuition, and today, we covered 37%. That is a vast lopsidedness in terms of where our values are. So it is important for all of us to hold our elected officials accountable in terms of where they are investing our dollars and the systems that we care about. We cannot expect a better education system if we are not investing in our children and our teachers so they can afford to live where they can.
Been articulated, but imagine if we held the standard of supporting and putting people in decision-making positions who are aspirationally ridiculous. Let me explain that. There were architects of the civil rights movement who deeply believed that we could desegregate schools. There were folks who believed almost 120 years prior to that we could actually end chattel slavery. There were folks who believed that we could actually tear down prison walls, and we are doing that, and they have done that. So I actually want to be a part of a new framework where we're putting folks in decision-making positions who think aspirationally, and those aspirations are so ridiculous, like housing everyone, right? Like making sure people have wonderful and seamless health care despite how and the ways in which they've come into the world. It's also making sure that the folks who can't navigate services have the most respect by the people who are paid to take care of them and keep them safe. Unfortunately, even in progressive cities like San Francisco, these very basic human rights notions are progressive and radical, right? And so I think it is time when we think about how
housing first. Laura Guzman, I don't know if she's in the audience, but she's one of my mentors. It's been a part of my life since I was a young person, and always said, if people are housed, then we start there. We can start somewhere. If we house teachers, if we house law enforcement folk, if we house folks who could potentially, our artists and musicians and spiritual leaders, we could actually have a beloved community. We are making it so that people who put the zest in the beauty of this city spend most of their time fighting to survive, and the first is no longer the beginning of the month. It's that dreaded day where you give 3/4 of your paycheck to live in substandard conditions to just try to keep a little peace at home and home. So it does mean erecting new facilities that are state-of-the-art to make sure that teachers want to stay and play here. But it's also like facilities that are right around the corner. My daughter, Amina, she went to the Boys and Girls Club for 7 years. And it was $10 a month, and as a community organizer, excuse me, a year. And it was the only after-school daycare that I could afford, and it was bustling. Now she's going to Davis, and she'll be a doctor. Blah, 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 blah. Wow. Club, and I think about places like Booker T. Washington that I went to, or Ella Hale Hutch. And yes, we do need to elect and empower ridiculously passionate leaders who have decision-making power, because what I'm afraid of is that those institutions will be empty. If you can't afford to raise a family here, what will this city be? What will become of the city of St. Francis? This is a city of revolution. Well, you know what? Because we are going to change that dynamic and that diaspora, I think that we stand up for what we believe in and we take back what's ours. This is our city.
There's two or three questions relating to public transportation here, which I'm going to try and merge. Lateefah has made the analogy to public transportation being the spine that holds together different classes, different communities in the entire region. And obviously, as Mayor Antonio, you addressed this, and as the board chair of the metro system in Los Angeles, right? You also served there. You also addressed this. But the problem, it seems to many people, that there's not enough political will and therefore resources to devote to the expansion of public transportation that we urgently need. And part of the problem here, once again, gets to back to something we were talking about earlier, where more and more people with money are seceding from the public transportation system just the way they did from the public education system. And as they do that through their Uber accounts corporate shuttle buses and so on, there's less and less public support then for measures that would expand public transportation. So politically, you had to address this, Antonio, Los Angeles, and Tito, you're going to have to address this soon when we get you elected to the BART board. How politically, starting with you, Antonio, did you grapple with that problem when the upper middle class and the middle class is seceding from public education? Transportation, rather.
When I first started talking about a subway to the sea, virtually everybody made fun of me. That was 2001. I lost that election. 2005, almost a month or so after I got elected, you know, the paper started writing, "Where's the subway?" It took a lot of work. It took a lot of work to build a broad coalition. Luckily, you know, traffic is so bad in L.A., and as bad as it is here, it is bad. I was in it just a few minutes ago. It's even worse there, because the number of hours, you know, there it's about 15 hours of traffic, 16 hours. So because of that, because of the air quality, we were able to build a coalition. The debate, though, was, what do we do with the transit money? The surrounding suburban areas wanted money for cars. And the city and me believed that what they were urban planners have told us, and that is every time you build a freeway, you will fill it almost immediately. And that freeways aren't the answer, particularly in dense urban areas. So we were able to convince them to give us the transit money, and they could have the car money for highways. But it was tough. And then, if you remember, in California, you need a two-thirds vote to pass a bond or tax, which is different than many states where it's just majority. And so we did this in the middle of a recession in 2008. Half-penny sales tax, and we'd already had two half-penny sales tax. But I think what we did that we can replicate here in San Francisco and in the state was something even more than that. And that was, we went to the federal government, who now, even the Democrats, won't raise the gas tax. So the Democrat and Republican just refused, even though Democrats and Republicans since the 1950s have always raised the gas tax when necessary. Democrats won't be a part of that conversation any longer, and where we come. What we did was we said, look, in a time of high debt and deficits, you ought to reward cities that are putting up their own money and give us loans and bonds that can leverage the money that we put in, that it can accelerate the building of those transportation projects and create more of a buy-in on the part of cities and counties and states across the country. That was called America Fast Forward. It was a $1 billion program that leveraged about $30 billion in loans. The state should be doing the same thing, rewarding your cities in San Francisco, LA, you know, Oakland, all these cities that are making these kind of investments and leveraging them to create good jobs. And by the way, you know, we do like San Francisco and LA, so we did a lot of community benefits. 40% of the people that worked on our projects had to live in the city. Because what used to happen is you'd come from all over Southern California to work in LA, and then you wouldn't vote for these bonds. So 40%, we did the high zip code with high poverty. We incentivized them. We did 2,000 African American premises because we didn't have African Americans on construction sites. We put women. We did people coming out of prisons. They had to have a percentage of them working on our construction. So we did a number of things. By the way, we did that as we built schools. Then we moved that to the transit system. And, you know, we were able to get double and triple bottom line benefits as a result. And that's why this conversation, in addition to having the kind of speakers that you have in the case of Jane and Lateefah, that's why you have so many people here. Because they recognize with smart and progressive leadership, you can have double and triple bottom line in these investments. And that's what we did. And that's what I think the state ought to buy into as well.
What about the mentally ill?
We'll get to that 1 minute. Antonio, I've been told that you have to run at 8:30 promptly. So if it gets close to that time, feel free to. It's what time is it, everyone?
Can we have shorter responses so we can get more
questions? Sure. We're going to have Lateefah's going to answer that question more briefly. And we'll try to get a couple more questions. But Antonio, feel free to leave us whenever you have to. And thank you so much.
I'm going to ask you how far about 15 minutes
with
this by car.
I
just think that we fight like hell for a living, and we
make sure that
people, whether it's in the market or it's closer to me. We make sure that we tell the stories of people who really, really need public transportation, whether it's in D.C., we procure money from the states, and we also encourage the private sector, again, to pay and to invest more into a system that their employees ride. I really am excited to secure new resources for public transportation when I get on the board.
All right, one more question here. Maybe two. I'm a working mother, homeowner, recently sent to a subpar school that makes me late to work every day because of the late start and lack of early child care. I guess she said there's a child who's been sent to the school. I'm perplexed as to why the city is so focused on building houses for people, but there's been no expansion or improvement of schools. This is pushing working families out of the city. It's impossible to get into a decent public school. It's too competitive. My kid's school has parts of the building missing, walls completely. Do you know what San Francisco will look like with no middle class? Are you doing anything about this? Who wants to tackle that?
When we were looking at the housing market here in San Francisco, you know, we heard a lot about build as much as possible, and all the rents will come down in San Francisco. But what we found that we were building was primarily luxury housing, right? And so let me tell you, when we were negotiating a lot of these deals with developers, we started to get a sense of, you know, their back of the envelope, and we found that not even for luxury, I'm not talking about the Millennium and Four Seasons, your average market rate rental condo that's being built today is being built for a family of four that makes $270,000 a year. That is market rate. And so I don't believe the answer to making San Francisco more affordable is building as much market rate. I think we have to build as much affordable and middle-income housing as possible. And so that is why I spend so much time working with developers, working with the city, make sure we are investing more there. But then we started looking at the luxury market, because it's an inefficiency here in San Francisco. And we started looking at all these different ways. Well, when there's an inefficiency, you look at asking a little bit more. So you tax that inefficiency. And so we looked at, you know, taxing second homes, vacation homes, because we found that a lot of units in South Beach, Rincon Hill, were actually just empty ghost neighborhoods on the weekends. And so we realized that a lot of people weren't actually living in these units as their primary residence. Unfortunately, it was very complicated to do this type of tax here in San Francisco for a number of reasons that I won't go into. So instead, we looked at raising the real estate transfer tax. And that is a measure that I've introduced, measure W, for November 8th, where we're asking those who pay above $5, $10, $15 million to pay just a little bit more when they sell those homes in their building. Because we can't stop the luxury market, but we can certainly ask those that are participating in it to give back a little bit to San Francisco to make our city more affordable. And we created a whole new category for $25 million that didn't exist before. We're the first city to do that. And we thought about, well, how do we spend that money? And the first instinct was, of course, let's build more affordable housing. We just passed a $350 affordable housing bond here in San Francisco, thanks to the voters in November. And so we started looking at, well, what are other ways to make San Francisco more affordable? And we looked into it, and education is one of them. And so that's why we decided that we are going to devote at least 50% of this new revenue that's going to come in November, and we're going to make community college free again here in San Francisco. Foundation to economic mobility, prosperity, but a real hard dollar. If you are a City College graduate with an associate degree, the jobs that are available to you pay on average $11,000 more than to the same individual with a high school diploma. So we know community college matters. And so we decided, well, let's use the money from the luxury market and let's help make San Francisco more affordable by putting more money in people's pockets. By making City College free for everybody, even the rent. We're going to make it free for everyone. And when this measure passes, because it is polling very, very well, thank you, but please vote for it and campaign for it, we will be the first city in the nation to make Community College free again for all of our residents, regardless of age, income, or any type of education we represent. State of California follows, and I hope that when we get a Democratic president in, that we'll be able to work with them on their higher education plan to make higher education affordable again for everybody.
Tuitions or subsidies for Trump University,
right? Oh, I forgot to add, we actually researched some programs in Oregon and Chicago where they're actually doing Free City Community College. And we actually have that here called the Boggs Waiver. And so what we were discovering was actually that that wasn't enough to get low-income students into community college, because books are now more than tuition. And in fact, there, I forgot the percentage, but it is a crazy percentage of students that are now enrolling in classes and not buying the books at all because they can't afford to do it. So if you qualify for the Boggs Waiver, and we want you to continue to apply for the waiver, we will also grant you $1,000 if you are a full-time City College student per semester to help pay for books, transportation, and hopefully we're going to work on child care as well, because we know that that is not the only barrier to going to higher education.
I'm assuming someone whispered in here that I have to go. But before I do, I just want to say that I think you have before you on the stage two women who, with your support, can go to the BART board in Sacramento, fight for affordable housing, be aspirational, passionate, strong in their determination to make this city and cities throughout the state a better place to live. So thank you for having me.
Final question of the evening. Does Lateefah believe that the commutercheck.org program should be expanded?
I love commuter check. I have commuter check. When I lose my commuter check, it's an issue. So as a working mother, you know, and I live in Oakland, again, I would at one point have loved to live in San Francisco again, being born and raised there and moving here, moving away later in my early 30s, I can't afford to come back. So I believe that everybody should be able to come back and not only like live, but also be a part of the civic and cultural and family life here in Access. So the answer is hell yeah. I mean, I don't know why. I'm an employer. I employ people. And I don't know why groups don't take advantage of the commuter check program, partly because we don't know about it. And part of one of the things that I think is going to be important about my role as a BART director is to really use communications and outreach, as I've done outreach for years and organizing for years. People on the streets and in homes and in places of business need to know and understand about the benefits that are due to them. And we don't do, I mean, forget signage and accessible BART. That's a number one priority, but people don't even know that they can actually get free tax benefits if they fight for them in their spaces of employment, so absolutely.
So just for those who don't know, doing a little Latin education, just explain a little bit more about commuter check and how it works.
Right, so commuter check is a pre-tax program, and I'm going to say the website wrong, so I don't want to do that, but if you do Google commuter check, Bay Area, and you can learn more about the program, employers, what they can do, you can sign up as an employee if they enroll in the program, and you can have a pre-tax designation to get you to and fro. For example, you put in $100, it's pre-tax, you get $100 in commuter checks, and you would take them to Muni and or BART. You add them to your Clipper card, and it's an enormous savings, and it gets more people, again, on public transportation. We need to really encourage people to get out of their cars. It's not only creating a more unsafe San Francisco to have everybody in their cars, but we are not creating an opportunity for increased air quality. I mean, it's, what is very, very real is as our air continues to get dirty, people continue to get sicker. We have to actually be about living and living in beloved communities. And that's why transportation is really not just about tracks and wheels. It is really about social and economic justice.
Legendary High School for hosting this town hall today. I want to thank Jane, Jim, and her great organization for asking me to host this evening.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's been my pleasure. And thank you, Ms. Jane.
Who is the amazing principal here. He's been a principal since I served on the school board in 2007, and his daughter goes to Mission High School, and I think that's speaks tremendously about some of the instructional and educational leaders that we have here. And I also want to recognize the guitar club for opening up for us today. But I just want to thank everyone for coming here. I don't pretend to have all the answers, and we don't pretend to have all the answers on the stage, but what we wanted to do was...